Hi, I'm Stephen Reifman, Steve Reifman. I don't care, just don't call me late for dinner. I'm a lawyer. I am a lawyer. I practice law. I've been doing that for approaching 50 years. And I'm here in Southfield, Michigan, just outside of Detroit. And I'm a very dedicated Detroiter. I've known Todd for a very long time and the whole Weinstein family. In fact, I just drove by the Weinstein home on Church Street in Oak Park just a couple of days ago, and I always appreciate that. And it was an amazing block, the Weinstein block. Had so many kids that I wish I had lived there. I felt like I lived in the odd area of Oak Park, but Todd's area was where all the action was. Basketball at the Bleckman House, you name it. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I've done a lot of stuff. I've written a book with a friend of mine about some traveling I did for a year overseas. And we just recently put out a movie. So I've had some endeavors in the artistic fields, not quite as much as my good friend Todd, though, whose art I appreciate.
What years does the book cover?
The book covers, actually, it starts at Woodstock. So that would be August of 1969. The book picks up again in October of 1970 and carries through to October of 1971, which is actually reflected. It's called a novel and it's fiction, but it is based on actual dates and actual travels that I took. And a lot of it is actual, but some of it is fictional. But it's from October. Basically, the adventure itself was one full year out of the country from October 1970 to October 1971.
And could you tell me the name of the book and possibly where one can get it or access it?
Yes, it's available on Amazon. It's called Wanderer, The Ultimate Hippie Trail Journey by Frederick Burke and Stephen Reifman. And Fred was, he's more the author. I don't really go for fiction. I like real stuff better, but I went along with it because it allows you to add some stuff that didn't happen that's perhaps a little more exciting, and it allows you to hide behind some fiction.
And is there a website that someone can access?
Yeah, there is. It's called wandererbook.com.
All right, great.
And it's got a lot of information, and we've done a lot of videos. In fact, during the pandemic, we published the book really just before the pandemic. And then during the pandemic, I was getting itchy. I stayed home for about a year and a half. And I decided that since it was a full year, that I would, as the year of October, which was a 50-year anniversary. So we dealt with October 1970 came up, and I was at 50 years. And I decided I would do a weekly wanderer kind of a journal entry, and we made like 20-minute versions. That's all on our website. We also have a lot of interviews and things. We came to New York. I actually visited with you, Todd, with Fred. We came and did an interview on WCBS radio and was in the studios there. Spent some good time and went up in the 1776 Tower with you, Todd. And Fred and I had a great time in New York City. Of course, that was just a few months later when things shut down for everybody. But so we did that, but there's a lot of fun stuff on wandererbook.com, which we think make for fun.
Great. Well, basically, I know that I asked you to do something for my project, Stories of Influence in Search of One's Own Self. I asked you to write something, which, again, I really appreciate. It's on the website, storiesofinfluence.com, under invitation, the writers that I've invited to write about it.
Yeah, and Todd, I dove into the website, and I got lost. I tried to find my piece, but I started reading Barry LaCrisse's piece about the mump, and it's a lot of information on there.
Did you find your piece?
I didn't get that far. I was enjoying other people's work too
okay,
much.
Well, you'll get it. I'll come back. It's right there. And it was a great opening, and I appreciate you coming to the opening.
And I came back again too, remember?
That's right, you did. You came back again with your wife, and that was really, really nice. And you guys have been a big fan for many, many years, and I don't take it lightly. And, you know, you've been a big influence on me all these years, of course, growing up, you and, you know, Rabbi Goodman and all the other, Al Ravitz, Jim Bleckman, Harvey Eisman, you know, and many more. I didn't
mention
some of the ladies, you know, I should also, you know, Janice Linderman, my sister, Marilyn Pitt, Ann Fishman, on and on and on. If you can, you know.
Well, Todd, you always have been an old soul, and you were, you know, there were some people that would have a hard time relating to people in other grades when we were growing up. There were so many kids around. You didn't have time to deal with somebody in another grade. But Todd, you could always handle anybody from an old man to a baby, to people your own age, people a few years older. It didn't matter to you because you seem to always have that eye to look into the soul.
I appreciate that, Steve. Here's one of the first questions. Of all the people whose work and lived have most influenced you, which one is least obvious in your life?
Wow. Now, are these people I actually knew, or these artistic people,
again,
or it could be anything?
Of all the people whose work and lives have most influenced you, so they could be living or dead, which one is least obvious? You know, that you, that at least obvious, okay, someone would know.
You know, I tell you, I started reading this morning on a Kindle a book called The Autobiography of a Yogi, written by Yogananda Paramahansa. And I don't know if you're familiar with this book, but it's a book. One time I knew a yoga teacher who I greatly respected. And she told me, she said, I read this book every year. And it is really an incredible book. I have a real thing for Eastern philosophy, Hinduism. Part of my one-year journey, I spent several months in India. I actually met with the Dalai Lama. That's reflected in the book. And I spent a lot, I was in Nepal. And, you know, that Eastern wisdom really strikes a chord with me. I try to practice some yoga every day. I meditate in the morning every day. So I think it's something, I don't wear it on my sleeve. In fact, I'm wearing a necktie. It's a Jerry Garcia tie, Grateful Dead, you know? So one of the things that happened to me in my life is that when I became a lawyer, here I am, I'm kind of a hippie, you know, and my hair was a lot longer than yours is now, Todd, and it was going off in spirals, and it was a red hippie hairdo. So now I decide, I become inspired, by the way, to become a lawyer, to actually go to law school when I was in Kabul, Afghanistan, on my way back from India. And while I was there, I had some revelations of sorts and said, I'm going to go to law school. So meanwhile, I'm still a hippie, though. And, you know, you're kind of out of place. And then you get to a certain point and, you know, you got to walk in a courtroom and I say, you know what? I became a federal defender, a deputy defender in United States District Court in the Eastern District of Michigan, right out of law school. And I walk in and I got this kind of wild red hair and a red beard and a red mustache. And, you know, I can't afford to risk for my clients that because I like looking like a schmuck, therefore they're going to go to prison or the jury doesn't like me, so they blame them. So I cut my hair. You know, it was a very bitter moment. I cut my hair before at a couple of occasions, once entering Morocco, because they wouldn't let me in. They made me get two haircuts, as reflected in the book too, our Wanderer book. I had to get two haircuts by the sea entering into Morocco. So I don't like getting haircuts. And then I decided I needed to get a job when I came back from my travels, and I went to work for an insurance agency, cut my hair, went to work. Then law school, that kind of set me free so I could grow my hair again. But now I'm in federal court representing people who might go to prison because somebody doesn't like the way I look. So I cut my hair and I've kept it cut since then, even took off the mustache because it seemed to turn white. Now, why am I mentioning that to you? Because this necktie, you see, could hang yourself wearing a necktie. You can choke wearing a necktie. It's a very bad thing, a necktie. It's for the straights, isn't it, Todd? Anyway, I made a decision about in the mid-90s. I found that Jerry Garcia of the Grateful Dead was an artist as well, a graphic artist, and he used to do designs and stuff. And they made ties with his designs. Jerry Garcia did not know this, by the way. Years later, somebody came to him and said, Jerry, what about all these ties you're making? He said, what ties? He didn't realize that someone had taken his full designs, and each one of these designs, this happens to be called Uncle Sam, by the way. They got names, right? So each one of these designs, they took them and they made them like as if they were like a paisley design. And me with my crazy mind think, hey, you know what? That's pretty cool. I always had this thing. I'll never forget this. There was an article when everybody was hippies and becoming hippies. And it was the article was about what is going to happen when the hippies start sitting behind desks and look like regular people, but they're still hippies.
We both still have a head of hair.
Yes, we do. That's a good thing. So the funny thing that happened is I actually bought about maybe a dozen of these Jerry Garcia ties in the mid-90s. I never liked going back to the regular ties. I started wearing them out. About 5 years ago, I figured out, the internet. I'm going to go on. I think I have 100 Jerry Garcia ties now. I never wear any tie unless it's designed by the Grateful Dead and Jerry Garcia. Why? Because it gets me to those roots that I still love.
That's a great story, Steve.
Thank you.
Number two, influence comes from people other than individuals working in the same field as our own. Who are some of the people not working in the same field as you have been most that have influenced you mostly? I mean, you kind of said that, but is there any other aspects?
Yeah, I another great influence to me is the writer Paulo Coelho, who wrote a book called The Alchemist. And he's a Brazilian fella. And he actually, interestingly enough, just after we put out our Wanderer book, he wrote a book called Hippie. And he was in Amsterdam, which is really kind of the beginning of my adventure for a year. I traveled in a propeller plane from New York City. It was called Loftleiter Air. It was actually Icelandic Air. We flew a propeller flight to Iceland. And the cheapest way to get to Europe in those days was you went to Luxembourg. Well, who the hell wanted to go to Luxembourg? Not me, but it was the cheapest way. It was like $118. So they told me, you don't need a round trip ticket. I only had $500 to my name. So I get off the airplane and they say, Steve, you got to buy a return ticket because we're not letting anybody in this country that looks the way you do that doesn't have a way out. So I had to spend another $118. So now I go to Amsterdam and I get there. It's about October the 7th, 1970. Paulo Coelho had been in his book, and he documents this, called Hippie. He was there in September, 1 month before me, and he met with a lady who talked him into going on a bus to go to Nepal. Guess what? He never made it. His story ends in Istanbul, where the real adventure starts, frankly. And he chickened out and wound up becoming a Sufi instead and stayed in Istanbul and went a different track. But anyway, his writings have really tantalized me. He talks about dreams and fulfilling dreams and inspiration. And I would highly recommend to anybody. And if you're not familiar with The Alchemist, it has sold more books. I think it sold like 50 million copies. Wow. It's this amazing. It's one of these things where once you run into it, you'll be giving it out to your friends. Yeah. And you can read it in an evening. But this guy really inspires me. And the book, Hippie, that he wrote was actually quite inspirational, even though he never made the hippie trail.
Very nice.
When I arrived to Santiago, I had a kind of sensation that, my God, now my life has no meaning anymore. And I said, what shall I do? I would like to be a writer, but so far, and I was 38, I did not dare to write a single line. Why don't I try now to fulfill my dreams instead of postponing?
The beautiful pilgrim service is a worthy end to this long walk of inspiration. On the road, the pilgrims have been challenged to think about their past, their present, and their future. And for many of them, there has been a lot to go through.
Por Jesucristo nuestro Señor.
For Paulo Coelho, this meant looking back. He grew up in a Jesuit family in Brazil. The upbringing was strict, with no room for emotional dreams.
Rebellion is a sacred flame. If you don't fight against the values that you see, if you take everything for granted, the world will never evolve. So, of course, I was a nightmare for my parents. They put me into a mental institution. Because when I was 18, 17, I don't remember exactly, they said, he's mad, he's crazy. So they put me in a mental institution not only once, but three times. I did not forgive my parents because they don't need forgiveness. They tried to do that because they loved me. You know, there are worse experiences in life than this one. How many people has a broken heart and spend the rest of their life, you know, suffering on that, incapable of accepting this energy of love again. So in the case of my parents, I don't think they needed forgiveness because they did not try to harm me. They tried to help me in a wrong way, but they tried to help me. Then when I left the mental institution, I said, okay, I cannot run for presidency. Because they are going to come with this paper saying, oh, he's crazy, he cannot run for president. But besides that, I can do anything because I'm crazy. You know? So I start, and it was the moment where the hippie movement really was the experience of my life. And then young people, different languages, but the same path. One of the parts of the hippie culture, it was traveling. So I start traveling, and you realize that you don't need a lot of things, but you realize also that people are there to help you. I do think that when you're not surrounded by your safe world, when you're vulnerable, like in a pilgrimage, for example, or when you travel, then you're much more open to other people. You don't speak the language, so you learn how to be dependent. And you learn also this is not something to blame, this is something to be proud of. When I was a hippie, I traveled South America and North America, and I only had $200. Still, I could eat, sleep, find girlfriends, whatever. because I realized, and I did not speak English or whatever. I was just traveling. So a pilgrimage, even if you walk fast, slows you down.
She who would valiant be gainst all disaster, let her in constancy.
Very nice. Number three. Whom, living but especially dead, would you most like to meet and why? And what would you talk about?
I think I'd go with Moses. I'm talking about the real guy. I mean, who has had more influence on the world than Moses, you know? I mean, even Jesus is a derivative of the Mosaic tradition and the whole ultimate consequences of this universe. I mean, when you think about the fact that there's three major religions fostered by Moses, and they make up the world's context. Although I mentioned Hinduism, which continues to be a fascinating poly-god religion, but I still think if you analyze where we live and the direct influences on it, I'd have to go with the main man, Moses, who set our people free.
That's super, Steve. Number four, suffering profoundly affects everyone. If you are comfortable sharing your experience, please describe how suffering has influenced your own work and perspective.
You know, I was just listening. This is also another real favorite influence on me. Maybe I should have mentioned him first, is the Vietnamese Buddhist monk Thich Nhat Hanh. One of his classic books is called Peace is Every Step. And he has this thing about breathing, which is essential to yoga and essential to meditation. So Thich Nhat Hanh was talking about Buddhism. And what he was saying is that suffering and happiness, you know, you can't be happy if you don't know suffering. What do you know? So listen, I've had many incidents and things in my life that have been tough times. And, you know, one of my gifts, and I think everybody has to a certain degree, but this is one that I'm particularly good at, is forgetting pain. You know, it's amazing. You can have the most pain. You cannot remember the most painful moment you had. You know, try it. You know, yeah, you can think about it, but you can't really feel it, you know? So the reality is, in terms of suffering, you know, it's part of life. You know, if you have good, it's going to be bad. Love and hate go together, you know? If you don't have strong feelings, you're not going to love anybody. And if you don't have strong enough feelings, you're going to hate them once in a while. So I think that the idea of suffering is very powerful. I don't know why I keep returning to the religious front, but of course the Buddhism was huge in the idea of really ending suffering by not even accepting it, by going beyond it in a certain way. Now, there's another guy I wouldn't mind meeting would be the Buddha. For some reason, all these religious characters seem to be very powerful to me. So when I was in India and Nepal, I actually wound up going to a place called Sarnath, the great Hindu city of pilgrimage is called Benares. It's also called, it's got another name, I'll think of it in a second, but Benares, this is where you see all the pilgrims going down to the Ganges River, and they come in and they soak and this and that. And I recently read a book, by the way, by a great person that was into the death consequences. And he was a MD, and his father, he was an Indian fella. And when his father died, he took his ashes back to Benares to take them and bury them, put them out on the Ganges River. Guess what happened to him? He swallowed some of that water and got almost deathly ill. So that river is some funky river in many ways. Can't imagine what goes on in it. But we're talking about, you know, also another great character would be, you know, the Buddha and how that reflects. And then when I was in the area, which we call Benares, and I went to Sarnath, and that was the place where it's called the Deer Park. And that is where Buddha gave his first sermon after he had been enlightened. He's under a bodh tree, and then he gives his sermon. So, you know, these very interesting highlight religious spots. And that's, by the way, one thing that I think is worth consequencing about in our discussions is that when you travel, and travel can be a great thing, you're always going someplace. You're never really, the road is fascinating, but you're always going someplace. And when you finally get to a location, that's what you were on the road for. You know, there's always one other place to go, whether it be going to Morocco or whether it be going home. But the road is tough. And I got to tell you something. I'm not even ambitious to go on the road again. Todd, you travel beautifully and still do. Every time you get on a plane, every time you're waiting for one, there is so much risk and consequence. And I think today is even worse than ever. It doesn't seem like a plane ever leaves on time anymore. But the idea of suffering, I think, is what you're asking me about. And I think suffering is just part of life, you know? I mean, you get a hangnail in your foot, it hurts you for 3 weeks, you know?
You know, it's funny because I started reading this book.
Oh, yeah. Karen Armstrong. She also has, what's her History of God, I think it's called.
Yeah, about all three gods, all three religions under one God. One God, the gift of the Jews.
Yeah.
Other one that
how's the book so far? Is it good?
It's good. Yeah. I mean, I'm a slow reader, so I'm dyslexic. So, you know, I pick it up and I get what I can, and it's awesome. And then the other thing is this book about Japanese death poems.
Wow.
where they it's written by a Zen monk. They write a poem prior to dying, and I'm thinking of the next project, sort of illustrating maybe some of these. It's something that I'm thinking about.
That's incredible.
Yeah. Let me go to the next question. 5, what would you like your legacy to be? What would you like your legacy to be?
Well, I have to say, I've been thinking about this, and the fact that we turned this book out, and then I got this movie we did where I spent a real lot of time on Woodward Avenue in Detroit. That's the main street here. And I was desperate, and we made a movie about a group that we formed and how we theorized whether or not we really made an impact. And of course, miraculously, the downtown area of Detroit, the 3 miles from the riverfront up to what they call the New Center area, has just blossomed. And I feel like I had a lot to do with that. And we made this movie that we published. We actually won an award at a film festival, the Central Michigan University International Film Festival, for the best Michigan-made documentary. But what I found is that area and what's happened to it is incredible. And I am really very satisfied with the fact that I left this book and I left this movie behind. And then there's one other aspect of it. It's my trilogy, if you will. I have become pretty political. And my politics in the 90s, which dealt with trying to rejuvenate a shamed city. Detroit was, they say it in Yiddish, a shonda. It was sickening. The town had been abandoned by anybody that had any money. And there we were trying to turn it around against all odds. So why do I mention that? Because of that time, I basically ignored the normal political stream of Republican and Democrat, which you really don't have much choice about in this country. If you wish to be pertinent and effective, you know, you can form a new party or join the Socialist Democrats or whatever you want. But to me, I got to a certain point where later in that agenda, I said to myself, Steve, there's only one way to prove I'm not a Republican, and that is I need to be a Democrat. And I still believe that. You cannot, in my opinion, especially now, it's gotten so much worse. You cannot be a Republican. It's like, what kind of a turkey are you? I mean, who would go along with this stuff? Who could go along with this Trump stuff? I don't want to get very political about it. But so I then became a Democrat, a relatively ardent one. And then in 2004, I ran for Congress because nobody else wanted to run against an incumbent in the then very Republican Oakland County, which is north of Detroit, where we all live together in Oak Park. And when I did that, guess what happened? A young man came along named Zach Smilovitz. His father is Bernie Smilovitz. He's a very famous sports newscaster on the 11 o'clock news on Channel 4, the NBC station here in Detroit. Very well regarded. He happens to live in my precinct. Bernie does, and his son Zach, who was at that point 17 years old, he made a movie about me running for Congress. He called it Swing State, starring Steve Reifman.
What happened was, we had a little event. We tried to create some drama. What we call Tax Day. Yeah, right there.
Tax Day.
And that's April 15th, you know, so we went to the Royal Oak Post Office, and we were out there just with a couple people taking pictures, actually. And Joe Nolenberg came out there with some of his, quote-unquote, supporters, and he was speaking. So anyway, Joe came there, and I said, "You're Joe Nolenberg? I'm Steve Reifman. I'm going to kick your ass." That's true. And you know what he did? He turned around and pointed to his rear end.
No.
So he had a little sense of humor, you know? And, you know, I don't need to be hostile to him personally, but I got a little bit rambunctious that day. But it was fun. And it was kind of funny, too. Then he spoke, and it was very ineffective.
Oh, yeah?
And I thought, my God, how is this guy our congressperson? You know where we're going, Joe?
I spent my life being a lawyer and working on cases. Those three things, the first of all, a movie that reflects on the activity in Detroit and hopefully turning it around. The second thing, the Zach Smilovitz movie called Swing State, starring Steve Reifman, and then our book. Those three things I feel are my legacy. Although I've got one more book and I am going to write it, I call it 12 Crazy Cases. One of the things that happened, because I'm the kind of person I am, I get involved with some very unusual people and cases. And I kind of call it flies to shit. I'm the shit, they're the flies, you know? So I get involved with stuff. So I do want, I've got this whole theory about writing books, by the way. I'd like to share it with you, Todd, real quick. My theory is that anybody can write a book. All you got to do is, first of all, decide what you want to write about. Then what you want to do is you want to write down the chapters, just the titles. In this case, my book about cases, I'm going to say about my friend Leonard Young. He was an incredible person, blah, blah, blah. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my phone and I'm going to put it on an email to myself. And I'm going to dictate, spew. I'm a good talker. I'm a good bullshit artist, right? And I'm just going to spew it out there. And then when I'm done, I'm going to take that thing. I'm going to edit up chapter one. Boop. I should be able to do a book in 12 weeks, doing each one, only one a week. Wow. Just, but I need to get to the, I'm going to get to discipline. That's the only book I can think of. I do want to ultimately write about my legal career. Some of my fun legal stuff had to do with our Woodward Avenue rejuvenation of the city of Detroit work. One was that we stopped the destruction of the old Hudson's department store on Woodward Avenue, which was like a monolith and was sitting dead. And we did something where number one, we painted we actually got 50 artists. It's reflected in our movie called Sparks, Detroit's Friends of Woodward. We got 50 artists to come and paint Heroes of Detroit on each window that was boarded up at that time. And it was my inspiration, because at that time, there was the great running back, Barry Sanders of the Detroit Lions. And someone was bold enough to put in that dead downtown a 60-foot high picture of Barry Sanders. And I thought to myself, heroes in the heart of Detroit. So we invented this Hudson's Project. Then, even though we actually found a developer from Madison, Wisconsin, that said, I can make this building great again. The city and people that work for the Taubman Company, the big shopping center company, they actually countermanded and stopped that and decided they were going to knock down the building. So we actually got an injunction and got the building. We got held up the destruction of the building. But then about 7 months later, the judge that had done that, she lost her election, which never happens in judges. And a new judge came in, and she had worked for the city of Detroit's law department. And she decided, let them knock the building down. So that was one of my fun cases. You also have one other case that I'd like to mention real quick that along the same genre, because in law, to get an injunction means you stop something from happening or you order someone to do something. They're disfavored in the law because the law says, you know, if it's money, they'll pay the money, but we're not going to just stop stuff because we don't know enough. So the other injunction that we got that was very interesting was I went and got involved with a guy named Tyree Guyton, who developed a project called the Heidelberg Project in Detroit. And there's movies about Tyree. He's quite a character. This is when Detroit was at its worst. And he would find objects and assembled them on a street called Heidelberg. Well, he started, and Tyree was unstoppable. I was on his board of directors, but it was a weak board of directors, and he was just kind of a one-man show. So at one point, he starts hanging, he finds pairs of shoes, and he ties them together, and he starts throwing them up in the trees that were hanging over the street. So the city comes along and decides, well, this is dangerous. Meanwhile, the city's falling apart, burning down, you name it. It was such distress. They decide they're going to take down the shoes off the trees. So we got an injunction and stopped that too, you know. And it was a lot of fun until somebody sobered up and they said, okay, we're not going to keep this. We're going to stop the injunction because money damage or whatever. So they came and the city came and they took down all these hanging shoes from the trees. I was destroyed. I thought, this is terrible, but I have to go down and see what they did. I went down there. It was the same pile of junk it was before. It was so much he had piled up there that it really didn't even matter. So there's two of my great crazy cases.
I just visited that place the last time I was in Detroit.
It's incredible.
Tell me
what you think.
Well, I've been there before, but I went again, and you know, I just visited it again. You know, it's just awesome.
And you know, frankly, it's become a little outmoded in a sense, because the reason why it was so pertinent in the 90s was because things were so bad and things just aren't that bad anymore. It doesn't have the same punch because things have really improved in Detroit and there's all kinds of pockets. And one of the things that I'm involved with right now is we found an area called East Pole Town. It's kind of like north and east from the Eastern Market. Bagel plants in front of it. You got like I-75 goes down the side of it, I-94 the top, and grass it like this. It's like a triangle. And I've got a friend of mine. If I have anything that I really am married to besides my wife, that is the idea of communitizing mankind, humankind. So I have this continued vision, and it comes from my man Moses, by the way. Exodus 18:13-26. Where Moses' father-in-law tells Moses, after they had already been to the mountain of God, he brought the Israelites, the children of Israel, across the Red Sea, brings them back to the real Mount Sinai, right? And when he's there, his father-in-law brings his two sons and his wife. His father-in-law was Jethro, and from Gideon. He was a Gideonite. And he brought his family together, and he comes and they have a reunion at the beginning of Exodus 18. But then in 13, it's the next day, and Moses is out there, and all the children of Israel are lined up. Moses, what about this? What about that? Jethro says, son, come here. I got to talk to you. You need to divide up the children of Israel into thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens, and you need to appoint leaders because they can't all be brainy if they got a hangnail. You know, let them take it up with the block guy. So I have this idea of building block clubs, universal system, and we're working on it right now, virtual block clubs, because we know if we can create virtual, then real may follow. Right now in today's world, if it's not virtual, it isn't real. And that's our theory. So we have a passion, and it came out, by the way, the movie kind of brought this up. So I have a passion for bringing up block clubs and nurturing them and developing them and making that real, because I believe that we need some element of human organization, and it's missing. And Moses had the key from, by the way, that was a Gentile that brought that wisdom of Exodus 18, not anybody from the children of Israel. So you Jews, don't be thinking you got all them good ideas, because we need to bring Gentile ideas into the fold. And that's the true Tikkun Olam, healing of the world, because who are we, preaching to each other? No. It also says, one last thing, in Exodus 19, the next book, the next chapter, it says, by the way, about the chosen people. This is a very thorny issue. I think it creates a lot of animosity, by the way. But what does it say? It says, you will be my chosen people if you follow my dictates, if you do what I'm telling you to do. And that starts with the Ten Commandments and ends with 613, what they call mitzvahs in the religion. There's so many things the Jews are supposed to do, you can't even count them all. Well, they did, 613. Point I'm making, though, is that we need to work on the world. That was one of my passions when I went down to Detroit, because basically the whole white population and the Jews had left the city in a state of destitution. My attitude was, no, I'm not being one of those guys. In fact, I used to get in a little bit of trouble because I would write letters to the Jewish Jews and say, hey, people, where the hell are you? What are you doing? How are you fixing things? And then there's that real point, and that's the real point, where it says, you shall be a nation of ministers. That's what God says to Moses and to the children of Israel in Exodus 19. Well, a nation of ministers? Who the hell do they minister to? Each other? No. We, if we are a nation of ministers, and we do what it says, we need to be ministering to the world, not to each other. What do you think?
I want to share something with
That's
you.
That's my rhetoric.
I want to share something with you.
Okay.
I don't know if you can see this.
Yes, I can. I know that picture.
That's Moses with the broken tablets.
I know it very well. I have a, I think you made a card of it. I think I have it on my bulletin board.
Oh, do you? Okay. I love that one. But I wanted to share that with you.
Yeah, that was the mistake. That's why they wouldn't let, God would not let Moses back into the promised land, because he got so angry when he was up on Mount Sinai for 40 days, came down and saw the golden calf and said, oh, I got the Ten Commandments. Boom. God said, you get yourself back up there for another 40 days and maybe. So then he leads them right back. I think it's called Mount Nebor. He's up there looking. He can see all the promised land. He can see the Mediterranean. He can see everything. He says, Moses, you ain't going no further. This is up to our man Joshua to carry on.
Well, Steve, is there any, like, one thought or feeling that you would like to leave us with, if somebody were to see this talk, could you sum it up in a kind of a short way?
Yeah, I guess if I had to, I'm gonna go to Jesus, okay? Because at one point they said to Jesus, Jesus, what's the main law? I mean, what's the, it comes down to it? What is it? You know? And he said, he cited two things, and they both come out of Deuteronomy. He said, love your neighbor as yourself. You know, I mean, that's hard. I got some neighbors right now I don't love right now, because they're doing things that are ticking me off. And I'm struggling to find that love, because the fellow named Ram Dass, another famous religious figure out of the 60s, he actually did a trip much like mine, but he found a guru. I never did find that guru. I'm still looking. That's why I think every man is his own guru to some degree. But anyway, he found this guy who was who was his guru. And he was just the embodiment of love. So one of my theories is that the reason, by the way, in case you didn't know it, Jesus was Jewish. And then some people say he was killed by the Jews. Well, that would be like saying, If I was hung here, I was killed by the Americans. Everyone's an American. Everyone was a Jew. So the reality is the idea of him being killed by the Jews, I think, is a false narrative. He was killed by the government, and certain Jews did it. So why am I mentioning that? Because of the fact that Jesus, I believe, was a person like Ram Dass's guru, who was so full of love that people started talking about it. I said, hear about this guy. That's all he talks about is love. That's all he does. Love, 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 love. And it became remarkable to the point where he took the Roman Empire from the year 32, when they were killing Christians, and in 240 years, it was a Christian empire. And there was no TV. There was no internet. How in the heck did that happen? Love. So I think the message, ultimately speaking, is love does conquer all, and we have to find it in ourselves, and we have to nurture that. Those seeds of love, if you don't have them, you're hurting yourself. So Trump, what he was able to do is he found these miserable people and riled them up and gave them guns. What do you think is going to happen? So this has got to be dealt with. And that, by the way, is why we need block clubs, because we need to know who lives on every block in every place. And if we find some miserable SOB who's got an AK-47 or whatever number they're calling them. By the way, I'm the guy, I've never even fired a gun in my life, and I don't plan on it. So what I'm telling you is that man has riled up miserable people that lived under rocks, turned them into a political force, and made them into dangers. We need to root them out. We need to take them and change them. And if we can't change them, figure out another way to get rid of them. Because I'm telling you, these guys are sickos, and they are what has despoiled this nation. And now there is no Republican Party. There's only a Trump Party. Sick. I can't help myself. I'm miserable because of this. And I know, Todd, you do very effectively. You are able to tell people forthrightly why the heck they're wrong about Trump. I've seen you do it. Man, I wish I had that recorded, Todd.
You know, I think Ram Dass's guru was Maharaji.
Maharaji, yes.
And you know, Krishna Dash was there. There were a few people from the West that went there and became very close to Maharaji. And you know, I know a lot about Ram Dass myself. I listen to a lot of podcasts called Be Here Now. I don't know if you know those podcasts.
Oh, I know. As a matter of fact, I will tell you this. So I come back from my year traveling, and I really was, you know, full of inspiration, thinking I'm on my road to Buddhahood, you know, and all kinds of stuff like that. So in my absence, I had a painting company, house painting, not art, you know, and we would paint houses. And I had a partner, and his name was Gary Sachs. And Gary, when I left, he took on another partner, and these guys got all into Paramahansa Yogananda, Yogananda Paramahansa, the author of the autobiography of Yogi. And there's this thing called the Self-Realization Fellowship, and they were going, and I come back and I say, yeah, I'll come help you guys paint. And I went out to their house, and Gary had an audio tape. There were no videotapes in those days. He had an audio tape of Ram Dass telling his story about how he found, what's his name again?
Maharaji.
Yeah. Okay. How he found him. He told the story. And he's telling me he was in the very places that I had been in. Yeah. I didn't meet Maharaji, but I was like, wow. And while I'm listening to him tell his story, I saw my third eye, literally. And I can find it again, but that was the first time. And it was only under Ram Dass's spiritual guidance that I was able to find my third eye. Yeah. That's real. There is a third eye. It's inside your head.
Well, I think I'll leave it on that note. One thing that I do like to leave this Zoom with is if we both could sort of touch the screen, you know, with our finger, just kind of come up and just touch the screen there. That's nice. Thanks. I like to do that at the end.
I like that too. I like to touch you. Yeah. You're fantastic. And I was telling you, I think before, we have your wonderful photograph of the Anne Frank tree at the Holocaust Memorial Center. I don't know.
Beautiful. Thanks, Steve, for that. So with that, Steve, I appreciate your time and all your insight into all your feelings about influence. And I will share that with everybody who will listen to this in the future. So thank
you. Todd, you've always been a great influence on me.